Good evening. Thank you all for coming on such a beautiful, beautiful night. I know it's a big thing to do that. First thing I'd like to ask is
for you to turn off your cell phones, turn them off, please. I'm Jim Gottstein with the Law Project for Psychiatric Rights.
And I'm extremely pleased to introduce our speaker tonight, Dr. Peter Gøtzsche from Copenhagen. He's with the Cochrane Collaboration, Cochrane, an independent research group that studies and issues reports on medicines and devices, all medical treatments. They don't have any conflicts of interest, and they're known around the world for their objective review of what the research really says. Dr. Gøtzsche has published over 70 papers in the five most prestigious medical journals in the world, and they've been cited over 15,000 times. He's published four books: Rational Diagnosis and Treatment, Evidence-Based Clinical Decision Making, Mammography Screening, Truth, Lies, and Controversies. Those are his first two books. And then in 2013, he wrote Deadly Medicines and Organized Crime: How Big Pharma Has Corrupted Healthcare. And then last year, he wrote, well, in Deadly Medicines, he had two chapters on psychiatric drugs. And he decided to write a whole book about that. And last year, he published Deadly Psychiatry and Organized Denial. I've got a few copies here if someone wants to buy them. It's just really excellent. I got to know Dr. Gøtzsche. He kind of insists I call him Peter. So I got to know Peter a couple years ago. I met him at a conference in Los Angeles, and we had a chance to get to know each other a little bit, and we're trying to collaborate. And the Mental Health Trust Authority was so kind as to give us a grant to bring him up. He's been here for a day and a half, and he's had some interesting experiences that maybe he'll talk about if in question and answer. I don't think it's in his main presentation. So please welcome Dr. Peter Gøtzsche.
Thank you so much, Jim. I really admire Jim's work, and I also cite it in my psychiatry book. I should say the crime book, the two chapters on psychiatry, the first one is called Psychiatry, the Drug Industry's Paradise, and the next one is called Pushing Children into Suicide with Happy Pills. It's a very dark chapter. So I will get started. A psychiatry without forced admission and treatment is a must. And I have no conflicts of interest, and of course the views presented are mine. What else could they be? Now, there are three perspectives you can apply on the use of force in psychiatry, and I will discuss mainly antipsychotics.
The scientific one is, does force do more good than harm? I believe clearly no. And antipsychotics cause vastly more harm than good. Ethics, is force ethically acceptable? No. Antipsychotics kill a lot of people and cripple many more. Legal issues, international declarations are being ignored. I'll come back to that. So we must change our laws because they are unjust. Now, first of all, do these drugs work? They are not specific as the name implies. Anti is a misnomer. Antimicrobial agents can cure us from infections. Antipsychotics don't cure anybody. It's a misnomer. And the placebo-controlled trials are highly flawed because they are not adequately blinded. These drugs have many side effects, so most doctors and patients will know whether they get active or placebo, and then the effects will be exaggerated. And then there is the cold turkey phenomenon in the placebo group, that in virtually all trials, you take people who are already in treatment, and then you have a short washout period of typically up to a week, and then you randomize to placebo or another antipsychotic drug. That means that you create abstinence symptoms in the placebo group in quite some patients. So you introduce harm in the placebo group. And then you conclude that my new drug is better than if I harm the control group patients. That's not good science. It's appallingly poor science. But that's how virtually all psychiatric drug trials are being done. Despite these heavy flaws, the effect of antipsychotics in recent submissions to the FDA is actually so small that it's doubtful it's clinically relevant. It's only 6 points on the positive and negative syndrome scale for schizophrenia, and psychiatrists have established that the minimally clinically relevant change, which means what you can barely perceive that now there is a change to the better, for the better or the worse, that's 15 points. So the Food and Drug Administration have approved olanzapine, risperidone, and drugs like that, despite the fact that the effect they have in deeply flawed trials, so this is exaggerated, is below what you can barely perceive as a change. So that tells a lot about these drugs. And then the schizophrenia diagnosis can be wrong in over 50% of the cases. So you subject people to forced treatment with very toxic drugs, and they don't even have an indication for treatment because it's wrong. That's another sign that we are not doing well here. The cold turkey design is clearly lethal. One in every 145 patients who entered the trials for risperidone, olanzapine, quetiapine, and sertindole, they died. And these deaths are unknown to the public. They don't appear in published trials reports, and the FDA didn't require them to be mentioned. That's pretty typical for the FDA. This is an agency that by and large protect the drug industry and not the patients. And we are not much better in Europe with our European Medicines Agency. Now let's look at the first of these drugs. Antipsychotics are really psychiatrists' poster child. And the first one was chlorpromazine that was launched in 1954. And in the beginning, the psychiatrists were sober, because they called it a chemical lobotomy, because it worked like lobotomy. People became quiet, apathic, or a chemical straitjacket. These drugs have no specific antipsychotic properties. They calm down people, and they lessen psychotic thoughts, but they lessen all thoughts. So it's difficult to exist when you take antipsychotics. 1 year later already, the hype was extreme. It was forgotten that this is a chemical lobotomy, and Harold Himwich, the president of the US Society of Biological Psychiatry, came up with a totally absurd idea that antipsychotics work like insulin for diabetes. It was purely fantasy. If you need insulin, and you get insulin, that's a remarkable treatment. You give people something that they have too little of. This is curative. People with psychosis don't need anything. They are not short of anything. And then psychiatrists like to say that these drugs emptied the asylums. Miraculous effects. That's certainly not true. The asylums were emptied for economic considerations, both in the United States, in the United Kingdom, everywhere where it has been studied. It had nothing to do with the effect of antipsychotics. So this is part of the folklore in psychiatry. There are so many myths and lies in psychiatry. It's pretty astonishing for me, who is a specialist in internal medicine. I never heard of any specialty where there are so many lies as in psychiatry. It's very strange. Now, there was an early double-blind trial where the National Institute of Mental Health investigators, and they had not been blinded effectively because these drugs have side effects, they saw the exact opposite of what is actually true when you medicate people with these drugs. because what they reported was reduced apathy. It's the opposite. Improved motor movement, not at all. Less indifference, totally wrong. So this tells you a lot of how unreliable trials in psychiatry are, that psychiatrists very often see or report what they would like to see. This is a psychological phenomenon. And they have failed to live up to their professional responsibility by neglecting to perform head-to-head trials between benzodiazepines and antipsychotics. When I lecture for patients or previous patients and ask them, if you should get admitted next time with a psychosis, what would you prefer, a benzodiazepine or an antipsychotic? Every one of them, so far, has said a benzodiazepine. Then why do we treat them with drugs that are among the most toxic drugs ever invented, apart from chemotherapy? It's not right. Now, in 1989, 35 years after chlorpromazine came on the market, the only two trials had compared the two types of drugs, and they produced similar improvements. Why hadn't loads of these trials been done? Because the drug industry controls everything. And the new drugs were very expensive, the old ones were cheap, so there was no incentive in showing that the old drugs were equally good or perhaps even better. So these trials were not done, but the psychiatrists could have done them. They didn't. There are now more trials, and there is a Cochrane review of 14 trials that showed that sedation occurred significantly more often on benzodiazepines. These trials are not very good, but the best evidence we have tells us that benzodiazepines are probably better. This is incredible. In my country, sometimes psychiatrists use benzodiazepines in acutely admitted patients with psychosis. But our guidelines say the same as in the rest of the world, that they should use antipsychotics. Now, since these trials are so flawed, can we trust meta-analysis of many trials in Cochrane reviews, for example? No, by and large, we cannot. There is a huge Cochrane review of chlorpromazine, 55 trials, 5,500 patients. And now look here, the abstract says that akathisia did not occur more often in the chlorpromazine group than placebo. There was no reservation for this statement. Now, akathisia is this extreme form of restlessness where some people say, I want to jump out of my skin. It means I can't sit still. They pace around frantically, perhaps. And this predisposes to both suicide and homicide. It's a horrible condition. How can it be that these drugs cause akathisia? And the largest trial that contributed data actually found significantly less akathisia on drug than on placebo, almost half as much on drug. That can't be true because antipsychotics cause akathisia. Placebo cannot cause akathisia. So what did we see in these trials? A cold turkey in the placebo group. The placebo group was harmed so much that you couldn't see how dangerous these drugs were. So this result speaks volumes about how flawed trials in schizophrenia are. And some Cochrane researchers, they realized this. So they wanted to study people with schizophrenia who had never been treated with antipsychotics before. How can you find such people? They virtually don't exist. So they went for first episode schizophrenia, where no one had been treated before, to avoid this bias. But they found so little, so that what they ended up with was a review of studies where a majority had first episode schizophrenia. They even included second episode schizophrenia, so they were likely already treated. And if the majority had first and second episode, then there must be some who had a third episode or fourth episode schizophrenia. So these trials were still flawed, but what they found was the available evidence does not support a conclusion that antipsychotic treatment in an acute early episode of schizophrenia is effective. Isn't it incredible how difficult researchers can be? Why don't they just say they didn't work? That's what it means. And the next sentence is even more difficult. The use of antipsychotic medications for millions of people with an early episode appears based on the evidence for those with multiple previous episodes. In plain English, these trials are crap, and we don't know what we are doing. So we treat these patients with drugs that I believe they would fare better without receiving. But then, how long should we treat them? Many of them are treated for years or for the rest of their lives, unfortunately. But some studies have been made where after successful treatment, you then try to stop the treatment to see if it's still necessary. And of course, you will have cold turkey symptoms if you stop treatment suddenly. That's pretty horrible. So these trials are also flawed. And you have them overall everywhere. In psychiatry, you have them in depression. So you introduce cold turkey in the placebo group, and then you say, oh yes, they still need the treatment. That's not good science. But here is a very rare good paper. Here, the researchers, after they had remitted, then the researchers randomized the patients to either reduce the dose or discontinue it completely, or just to continue with the dose maintenance for 2 years. And after 2 years, the doctor could decide the treatment. So, what happened after 2 years? Well, more had relapsed when they lowered the dose or stopped the dose than if they continued. But recovery was the main outcome. Who got well? Well, after 7 years, more people had recovered when they had their dose reduced or stopped, 40% versus 18%. And the dose in the last 2 years was 64% higher in the maintenance group, and stopped drug completely at 7 years. 11 had stopped during this period of time in the dose reduction group versus 6. So they got less drug and they fared clearly better. We have other evidence that supports this, that the less you use of antipsychotics, the more likely it is that your patient comes back to life and get a work and get on with life. So these antipsychotics, they create chronic patients. That's what they do. And how do we find out if they kill people? Some leading psychiatrists say that antipsychotics actually help people survive. That's pretty far-fetched. Such toxic drugs, how can they help people survive? And then they built their view on very bad research. If we use the randomized trials in schizophrenia to find out if these drugs are lethal, then it's flawed because we have deaths in the placebo group because of cold turkey. So we can't use the schizophrenia trials. So I went to the elderly with Alzheimer and dementia where these trials had been tried because I thought, well, then likely a good deal of these people were not in treatment before, so there was no cold turkey in the placebo group. So what did that show? Well, for every 100 people treated for a few weeks, there was one additional death on drug compared to placebo. So this is damning evidence that we kill a lot of people with these drugs, and that was only throughout some weeks. And considering the huge weight loss that many people acquire, and they develop diabetes and heart problems and so on, it's very difficult to imagine that these drugs save lives. They don't. They kill a lot of people. And they do a lot else. They cripple people. They lead to irreversible brain damage that can start pretty quickly and in a dose-related fashion. The longer and the higher doses, the worse. And few people get back to normal life compared to if you hadn't treated them with drugs. You become dependent on virtually all psychiatric drugs, so you can get abstinence symptoms if you stop suddenly. And you can get psychosis even if you are still on the drugs, because you change the brain in such a way that you can get what is called a supersensitivity psychosis. And that's typical for many other psychiatric drugs, that they can actually create the diseases they were supposed to work for, or even worse diseases. So they are really double-edged swords that doctors have extreme difficulty handling. They can't. So let's go back to the ethics. Is force ethically defensible? No. A few hours or days of disturbed behavior are treated as a cause for a lifetime sentence to a drug treatment, and psychiatrists in training will hardly ever see a patient who is not already snowed under with drugs, and therefore get a wrong impression both of the patient and his strength and the potential for cure without drugs. So typically when patients have strange movements and tics and salivates and so on, these are drug effects. But many people believe this belongs to schizophrenia. That's a disease effect. It's not. Some psychiatrists feel they cannot live without forced treatment. Most of them feel that. But they should think about that the patients cannot live with it. They actually die from it. That's far worse. And only soldiers at war and psychiatric patients are forced to run risk against their will that might kill or cripple them. But soldiers have chosen to become soldiers. Psychiatric patients have not chosen to become psychiatric patients. So this is deeply unethical. And as we all know, power corrupts. And the power imbalance in psychiatry is extreme. So there is a high risk that forced treatment is being used to benefit the staff rather than patients in order to make their work less stressful. We know that this happens a lot. I have estimated antipsychotics have killed hundreds of thousands of people and have crippled tens of millions. It's really gigantic. Some patients who were killed have begged what they call their torturers not to get the drugs, and very few have been investigated for slow metabolism, which can increase the risk of death. Quite many people have different metabolism from average, slow, intermediate, or fast. Here is a heartbreaking story of a Danish girl written by her mother, how psychiatry killed her daughter at age 32 after her 14-year career in psychiatry. She was a slow metabolizer. Her mother begged the psychiatrist to have a test done, which he refused. When Louise's best friend suddenly dropped dead on the floor at the hospital in Denmark, Louise said, "I'll be next." She was killed 6 months later. At one point during all that, she asked her mother, "Mother, do you think it's better in heaven?" It is so cruel. And very few will believe in forced treatment after having read this book. You will have tears streaming down your chin if you read this book, so I can recommend this for you. The diagnosis was wrong. She didn't have schizophrenia. She had Asperger. The psychiatrist didn't listen, not even to their own staff, who knew Louise much better than they did. And they declared that she was seriously ill and should have even more drugs, when the staff said she's doing fine. They consistently blamed Louisa and her mother for everything. It was never the precious pills, and certainly not themselves, that were at fault. This is quite typical as well. And they increased the dose when it should have been decreased or stopped altogether. Louisa didn't tolerate the drugs, and she was aware that they would likely kill her. Post-mortem, the system congratulated itself for its first-class homicide. Louisa had received the highest standard of specialist treatment. That's what we say when we kill people in psychiatry in Denmark. Cause of death, unknown. The officially accepted term for such death is natural death. How natural is it that a 32-year-old girl suddenly dropped dead? We know that psychiatric hospital contact is pretty fatal. We know that from a large Danish register study of 2,500 suicides. The closer the contact with psychiatric staff, which often involves forced treatment, the worse the outcome. The suicide risk is 44 times higher for people admitted to a psychiatric hospital compared to those who don't receive psychiatric treatment. And then you will, of course, think, isn't that natural? Those who are most ill get admitted to hospital and they kill themselves. That's not because of a bad environment at the hospital, but actually, most of the potential biases in this study favored the null hypothesis of there being no such relationship. So this study is pretty strong. And there was an editorial that said it's entirely plausible that the stigma and trauma inherent in psychiatric treatment, particularly if involuntary, might cause suicide. People in my country are still told, not always, but sometimes, schizophrenia is a chronic, lifelong disease and you need to be drugged lifelong. And then they leave hospital and have no hope. Is it strange that some people kill themselves at this point when they also suffer from horrible side effects? I don't think so. And schizophrenia is not a chronic progressing disease. People can get cured from schizophrenia. So now we come to Alaska, because the Alaska Supreme Court has decided that the government cannot drug someone against their will without first proving by clear and convincing evidence that it is in the best interest of the patients and there is no less intrusive alternative available. I have told you about benzodiazepines. That's less intrusive. There is always less intrusive alternatives available. And Jim Gottstein, himself a previous patient, used scientific evidence to convince the judges. In another case, the court decided that if the alternative is feasible, the state has either to provide it or let the person go. Jim has also noted that psychiatrists with a full understanding of the trial judges regularly lie in court to obtain involuntary commitment and forced medication orders. I got that experience yesterday. The petitions I saw were full of lies. It was unbelievable. We can discuss that later. Now, the legal issues are, for example, the European Convention on Human Rights that is about prohibition of torture. No one shall be subjected to torture or to inhuman or degrading treatment or punishment. And we have a committee for the prevention of torture that travels around and visits psychiatric institutions and write reports with criticism. And they say that patients are often restrained, usually mechanically, in belts as a sanction for perceived misbehavior or as a means to bring about a change in behavior. That's not allowed. And where physical restraint is necessary, it should in principle be limited to manual control, that you fix the patient like this. Talking to the patient or calm him or her down is the preferred technique. And Peter Bragin from New York in particular has shown how effective this can be. You can talk people down and you need to be kind to them and respect them. then you rarely need drugs. And if the patient wants something to sleep on, a benzodiazepine will do it. And then the excuse that mechanical restraint requires is good because then it liberates staff for other tasks. That's wrong. It requires more, not fewer, medical staff because you need constant surveillance. Some people die when they are mechanically restrained. Not many, but at one point it was 100 per year in the United States. Psychiatric patients should be treated with respect and dignity and in a safe, humane manner that respects their choices and self-determination. That certainly doesn't happen here in Alaska. And the torture committee all too often finds that fundamental components of effective psychosocial rehabilitative treatment are underdeveloped or even totally lacking. So it's all about drugs or electroshock or bells. And that the treatment provided to patients consists essentially of pharmacotherapy. There isn't a single randomized trial that has compared seclusion or mechanical restraint with no such intervention. But as I said, these measures can be fatal. An electroshock is fatal in around one in 1,000 that are treated. Now, we have a human right to equal recognition before the law. It should apply to everyone, also to people with mental disorders, but it doesn't do so currently. But the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, ratified by virtually all countries apart from the United States, Jim Gostein told me. It's the only country in the world I know of that hasn't ratified this convention. That's your country. So this convention says that member states must immediately begin taking steps to realize the rights by developing laws and policies to replace regimes of substitute decision making. We will decide what is good for you by supporting decision making which respects the person's wishes, the person's autonomy. People have the right to be free from involuntary detention in a mental health facility and not to be forced to undergo mental health treatment. It's very clearly formulated there. So forced treatment is a violation of the right to equal recognition. You already heard that. And an infringement of the rights to personal integrity, freedom from torture, freedom from violence, exploitation, and abuse. And as everybody knows, violence breeds violence. So when patients are violent in wards, it's often because of the inhumane conditions they have experienced. It's not their disease. It can be, but it's usually not the reason. So it goes on like that, this is a violation found all over the globe. Despite, this is important, despite empirical evidence indicating its lack of effectiveness, so it doesn't work, and the views of people using mental health systems who have experienced deep pain and trauma as a result of forced treatment. So we introduce a lot of harm for no benefit, virtually no benefit. It's very little, and very little compared to the harm. So those who are the first ones to meet the patients, first responders, they must be trained to recognize people with mental disabilities as full persons before the law and give the same weight to their complaints and statements as they would have for anybody else. That doesn't happen today. Unsoundedness of mind is not a legitimate reason for the denial of legal capacity. I saw that on all the forums yesterday. The patient is unable to give informed consent. That is simply not true. Very few psychiatric patients are not able to give informed consent, but it's used as an excuse for applying force. And the concept of mental capacity is highly controversial in itself. It is not an objective, scientific, and naturally occurring phenomenon like elephants in Africa. Mental capacity is contingent on social and political context, as are the disciplines, professions, and practices which play a dominant role in assessing mental capacity. And who assesses mental capacity? The psychiatrist, who has an enormous conflict of interest and believe in these drugs and all the other things. The patient is defenseless, essentially. Where is the independent observer here? Gone. Then we have these advanced directives that are very important according to the convention. So people should, if they state their will and preferences before they get admitted to hospital, they should be followed, they should be respected. And the point when they enters into force and ceases to have effect should be decided by the patient and not by the staff. And if you cannot find out what the patient really means, because the patient is deeply disturbed, it is the best interpretation of will and preferences must replace "we know what is best for you." That's how it is today. We must try to interpret, and we can ask the relatives. So, in Denmark, we have two ways we can admit a patient involuntarily, and I suppose it's pretty much the same in the States. That one of them is that if a patient is insane, they can be admitted involuntarily. If the prospect of cure or substantial and significant improvement of the condition would otherwise be significantly impaired. But this is never the case. What treatments do we have in psychiatry that means that if we don't force the patient into a hospital, the prospect of cure will be substantially and significantly impaired? We don't have such treatments. It's fantasy, it's pure wishful thinking. So this clause shouldn't apply to anybody. Then we come to the next one. If the patients are dangerous to themselves and others. But that's not really necessary either. In Italy, they have a law that says that you cannot admit a patient involuntarily because the patient is dangerous. This is a matter for the police. In Iceland, the same. They call for the police, and the police stay at the psychiatric ward. Same laws for everyone. No discrimination there. And in ethics, if you want to treat a person in situation A differently to a person in situation B, then you must be able to find an ethically relevant difference between situation A and situation B. That's pure logic. So let's look at this. In my country, doctors cannot give patients insulin without their permission, not even if the lack of insulin might kill them. And if adult people are Jehovah's Witnesses, we cannot give them blood transfusions if they don't want it, even if they might die. I learned today that in the United States, you can force such a person to receive blood transfusions. We don't understand that in Denmark. We value personal autonomy higher than this. If people decide for themselves, let them decide. Some people do very dangerous things. They drive a motorbike without helmet and as fast as they can and all that, and some die. People do a lot of things that kill them. We have to accept that. The only drugs that can be given without permission are also some of the most dangerous ones. And I have estimated in my book, based on the best science I could find, that psychiatric drugs are the third major killer after heart disease and cancer. They kill an enormous amount of people. And then there are the colossal misconceptions. It's a common law assumption that if a person is unable to give consent, the health professional acts in accordance with what she herself would have preferred. But we cannot assume that a severely psychotic person would want psychotropic drugs, or that she is unable to understand what is being proposed or its consequences. For example, she might decline drugs because of previous experience of serious harms. A patient can be floridly psychotic. That doesn't mean that they don't know what it means to take an antipsychotic drug and want to not to be treated. It's again a violation of human rights. And laws about forced treatment surely build on the harmful misconception that antipsychotics have a specific effect on psychosis, which is good for people. They don't have such an effect. Now, in 1975, patients in the United States took their fight to courts and battled for their rights, and at the same time, Soviet dissidents smuggled out manuscripts describing neuroleptics as the worst sort of torture. It's rather difficult to explain how the same substance can be a poison in one country and a helpful remedy in another, particularly as the poison was used as forced treatment in both countries. And we can do a lot instead of force. Assertive communication rather than intervening too late in turmoil. Basal exposure therapy, if people are very afraid of something, like if they have a phobia, you can expose them to it gradually. Offering drug-free alternatives, that will be introduced in Norway now. So this is a way of getting rid of forced treatment, because if you can decide, I want to come to a psychiatric department where I won't receive drugs, then we are already on our way of banning forced treatment. That's very good. I tried to get political backing in Denmark for the same, and there is interest in this. And few people who need being calmed down will refuse drugs, but let them decide themselves. Always have plans for tapering off drugs. They virtually never exist, and the psychiatrists have never learned how to do it. So typically, they lower the dose to only 50%, and then people get very bad. You need to take very, very little, typically only 10% of the dose, and then wait for a while. No one ever taught them, but everybody taught them to use drugs. The drug industry, but how to stop them? No. Psychotherapy works for schizophrenia. We found that out 2 years ago because some people refused to be treated with antipsychotics, and then a trial was done on psychotherapy. Of course it works. And if you try to find out why did that patient have a psychosis at this point in time, what happened to you earlier in your life, it is so incredibly important to find this out. But modern day psychiatrists, they rarely have time of taking, they have time, but they prioritize differently. They don't take the full story. I hear stories from patients that have been zombies for 10 years until they met a good psychiatrist that actually took a history and then found out what was wrong with them and started to take them off drugs, and they became healthy. Open dialogue is invented in Finland, in Lapland, which means that if a patient becomes psychotic, you involve the family within the first 24 hours, and you use drugs very, very little. You talk to people, you use empathy and love, as Peter Bragging would say. You respect the people. And then you can have the police if it gets dangerous. And then there is the good cop and the bad cop. If you have been a cop and have used force, it's impossible to change that role the next day and now pretend that now you're a healer and want to do the best for the patient. You can't do that, really. Maybe you can sometimes, but usually not. This is why psychiatrists should not act as police officers. And violence breeds violence, as I said. Then there are the community treatment orders. I heard about that today, that even when you get out of hospital, then you are not free from these drugs. So you can get forced treatment still, and if you don't take your tablets, you can get an injection. There is a Cochrane review, and there was no difference in service use or in anything else, and in the UK it was hoped that community treatment orders would lead to fewer hospital admissions, but the admissions increased. And there was great variation in these orders, some areas discharging half of the patients with treatment orders and others not at all. So some psychiatrists just felt, now it's too much. We won't use this. This is unethical. And there is a huge risk of abuse with community treatment orders, a catch-22 situation. Now, if a patient's distress is considered manageable, the professionals may well argue that the setup is working and should be continued. But at what point should it then be stopped? And what if it doesn't work? Then forced drugging is often increased, causing even more misery and more death. Mental Health Act police officers. Then we have some border cases that I always hear about when I want to ban forced treatment and forced admission. What should we then do with people with anorexia nervosa? Well, if life-threatening, we are allowed to intervene, actually. I said before that we cannot give people insulin against their will. So I seem to be contradicting myself, but we actually have laws in my country where we can intervene if we think a patient is almost dying. We can do that. We can also intervene in insulin coma. We cannot intervene as long as the patient is conscious. We're not allowed to do that. And what about mania? That's a difficult case. If you write a check to the Pope of $1 million and do all sorts of funny things, that's very difficult without force. How do you deal with these people? I don't say this is easy, but one of the things we could do is to take away all the legal capacities of that person so that person cannot write any more checks. We can do that without forced treatment, without these damn drugs. And you should also notice that if we abandon forced treatment in psychiatry, it will produce vastly more good than harm. But of course, some people will suffer, like some maniacs. But it's the same everywhere in healthcare. Chemotherapy will produce vastly more good than harm for some cancers, but some people will get killed by it. That's always the case. We cannot save everybody. And we can have a psychiatry without force. This has been demonstrated in Iceland, where a psychiatrist burned the shackles in 1932, and they haven't been used ever since on Iceland. Norway, Akershus, that's close to Oslo, doesn't have a regime for rapid tranquilization and has never needed one in the last 20 years. That's up in Norway. What happens in the States and in Denmark when a psychotic patients come in the door? Immediately that poor guy is treated with an antipsychotic. That's the standard. In Norway, they don't have a regime for this. That's pretty amazing. And in London, the psychiatrist waited on one hospital an average of 2 weeks before they did anything in terms of drugs on newly admitted people. And most people chose to take some medication, often in very small doses. They decided it themselves. So it's very well possible that it was respect, time, and shelter that helped the patients, not the sub-treatment threshold doses. And in northern Italy, force is not used. The head of psychiatry argues that you have to completely prohibit coercion since the employees would otherwise use it and not develop other approaches that means that coercion is not necessary. And I read in the Norwegian the official TV broadcasting homepage. I read yesterday that the psychiatrists were confused in the whole of Norway because the minister had told them they should now provide medicine-free departments. Their confusion was, but what should we then do? We always treat people with drugs. help, we don't know what to do without drugs. That's pretty scary, isn't it? But now they have to do it because the minister tells them. Now, a Northern Ireland priest and writer, he wrote something very interesting. Of all tyrannies, the tyranny sincerely exercised for the good of its victims may be the most oppressive. It would be better to live under robber barons than under omnipotent moral busybodies. The robber baron's cruelty may sometimes sleep. His cupidity may at some point be satiated. But those who torment us for our own good will torment us without end, for they do so with the approval of their own conscience. This is very central to what I want to achieve with psychiatry. Now, we have our problems. Only 2 years ago, the Danish Ministry of Health issued a license to kill. It allowed psychiatrists to use extraordinary large doses for forced treatment and said that this applies especially to patients who have been in prolonged treatment and where smaller doses have been tried without a good therapeutic result. But these are the patients who should have their drug withdrawn. Exactly opposite. Giving more of what was already not working doesn't help, it kills. Rest in peace. Forced treatment, thanks, not the patients.
So, do people have questions? And we have a microphone here. That should work. Go ahead.
Yes, I'm disturbed by the treatment of prisoners in America. They say that a large number of American inmates are mentally ill, and there's a large number of deaths. You know, the prisoner guards are reported to be very brutal with the prisoners. So how do other countries handle these cases of mentally ill patients without causing a death?
I don't know so much about this. In fact, what I know most about is what you have just told me, that it's a very dark chapter in America, the way you treat prisoners. And what I have perceived in Europe, it's not nearly as bad as you have it here in America. I'm sorry, but that's my what I heard. But I haven't studied the science about this. But it's not surprising that people in American prisons, they can become very psychologically disturbed in this environment. And drugs are not the solution of this.
Oh, here's someone.
Yes, my question is about the cause of death that was referenced often during your speech. What are we talking about when we're discussing cause of death? Is it a reaction to the drug? Is it suicide? What are the variants of that?
That is not easy to study. If an extremely overweight person suddenly dies of a heart attack, the cause of death will be heart attack on the death certificate. But this is misleading. How could the drug be left out of this equation? So what I look at is, what is the life expectancy for people with schizophrenia? And you know, this is 20 or 25 years less than the rest of the population. And another reason for this is that these drugs are so terrible that some people start smoking in order to cope with the drugs and their side effects. And they can smoke quite heavily. And that also contributes to the death. And that wouldn't have happened if they hadn't received these drugs. So if you then die from lung cancer, it's called lung cancer. It's not called you got a drug that you never should have received for so many years. It's a medical error. It's never on a death certificate. And then these drugs can cause sudden heart death. You suddenly drop dead. For example, because of electric disturbances in the heart, prolongation of the QT interval, it's called technically. Antidepressants also prolong the QT interval and increases the risk of arrhythmias that kill people. So if you get several types of antipsychotic drugs, you increase the risk of sudden death. And of course, then we have all the falls, that when you walk around in a cloud or what you should call it, and you are confused and so on, you will easier fall and can harm your head or break the hip, and that's also dangerous.
I just wondered whether hospitalization or forced medication when people are suicidal is ever justified, or do we go ahead and step back and allow people to choose, even if we feel they're not making a choice that people would like?
Can you be more precise on that?
Well, I feel I worked for a while in crisis intervention at a hospital where people who were taken in by the police or relatives,
yes,
or whatever had to be sent, unfortunately, if there were no other options, to API, whereupon
what is API?
The Alaska Psychiatric,
yes,
Institute, where they might have been subjected to medication against their will and or weren't allowed to leave for the 72-hour,
yes,
period. And
I think I can answer that question.
Didn't like that, but I don't know if the alternative of letting them kill themselves is acceptable either.
Well, I can refer to Peter Bragin and other of my heroes. Peter Bragin never uses psychiatric drugs. He never uses force. And there are other psychiatrists like him. And he has explained to us how he deals with patients like that. Drugs are not the solution. These drugs seem to increase your risk of suicide. It's not the other way around. Antidepressant drugs also increase the risk of suicide. It's not the subject for my talk tonight, but a lot of suicides on antidepressant drugs have been deliberately concealed by the drug companies. So there is no upper age limit where it's safe to take antidepressant drugs. They do increase the risk of suicide. And we don't know if there is an upper age limit where this is not the case. But we do know that if elderly people take antidepressants, a lot of them fall and break their hip and die. So the death rate in elderly people who take antidepressants is pretty high. And in young people, well, many are pushed into suicide with drugs that don't help them. So the whole idea of psychiatric drugs is a wrong one, in my opinion. We have created a completely wrong system. We should use psychiatric drugs almost not at all, very, very sparingly, and never against the patient's will.
Yeah, I wonder if you had any comments on the use of psychiatric drugs on patients with delirium.
Patients with delirium?
Delirium.
I didn't get the word.
Delirium.
Delirium. Well, delirium is a life-threatening situation. So you should treat it with the drugs that we know work for this situation. That is a rather special case. And of course, you can say a patient who is delirious may be so acutely psychologically disturbed, so it's impossible to communicate with that patient. But then, according to United Nations, you should treat the patient according to what you think that patient would have preferred in a state where the patient was not delirious. And I think most people would prefer to be saved in that situation, so that would be natural. That I will not call forced treatment. It's more like if somebody falls in the harbor, you are actually allowed to try and save them from drowning. It's more similar to that, but I know there are these subtleties that need to be worked out if we don't have forced treatment. I don't know if I was clear enough. I hope so.
What about if somebody thinks you have delirium and ultimately you found not to have delirium?
Well, I don't think it's useful to discuss all sorts of academically highly interesting, very rare cases. Let's look at the broad picture where we are killing and harming so many people today. We have a system that is not functioning. And then we can deal with the rest when we have gotten rid of forced treatment. As I said, there will always be casualties in healthcare, even if we do our best. There will always be. But not so many as today.
I have two questions, a comment and a question. So the first comment, I thought it was really notable what you said about Iceland treating people who are violent and mentally ill the same as people who are violent and not mentally ill.
Yes.
Right? Because it's the violence and commission of crime and harming others. My observation about that is that in this country, that would have a pretty significant impact on our court system because a determination of mental soundness is very important a lot of times. You know, people try to claim a mental health as a defense, mental health issue as a defense, being insane, and therefore I can't be given the death penalty or a life sentence in prison for committing this murder because I'm insane. So we have the insanity plea here, that's what they call
it. That's always interesting, but I think it's a little off the point. It's a little off the point that the police is handling dangerous people. These are two separate issues. It looked like you were tempted to reply to that, Jim, is that correct?
Well, I was just going to remark that when people interpose, you know, say that they were mentally ill as an excuse for not being responsible for a crime, they're usually sentenced to much longer period of time in a psychiatric hospital than they would be if they were actually convicted of the crime.
Yes. And I can give you an absolutely horrifying example. I was an expert witness in Holland, where a mother was put on paroxetine, an antidepressant drug. She started to have nightmares about cutting the throat of her two children. She developed akathisia, this terrible condition that predisposes to suicide and homicide. Her psychiatrist didn't do anything. This was medical malpractice. They should have taken her off that dangerous drug. And then one morning, she cut the throat of her two children and killed them and tried to kill herself with the same knife. And I was an expert witness, and it was so clear to me that this would likely never have happened were it not for the antidepressant drug. It was so obvious. So I told the judges that they should be interested in the psychiatrist rather than the accused, because it wasn't really her fault. And you know what happened? That was the, not the Supreme Court, it was the Superior Court in Holland. They sentenced that woman to lifelong confinement in a psychiatric institution, lifelong. If we in my country plan a murder, first degree murder, murder someone, and behaves well in prison, we come out after 12 years. That woman will be tortured for the rest of her life. That's what they wanted. For what use? She has a horrible life already. She was not herself when she committed these murders. This is typical for these murders. She was absolutely not herself. She didn't understand. And when the police came, she didn't understand anything. It was first a day or two later that she somehow started to realize what this was about. This case has been appealed to the Supreme Court in Holland. And I expect to go down to Holland in the Supreme Court. And it was also appealed by the prosecutor. They obviously felt it wasn't enough. I can't see how it could be worse. And I succeeded to raise a debate in Holland. I knew some journalists who were interested in my work and my books, so I contacted one of them. So it became front page news what had happened in court, and that led to questions in Parliament, like, are Dutch judges too harsh compared to neighboring countries? They surely are. This would never happen in my country. So in Holland, they somehow have a tradition of being very, very punitive towards people who would not have committed that without the drugs. It is deeply, deeply unacceptable. So I hope the outcome will be different in the Supreme Court.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry, I'm crying my eyes out because I had a very similar experience to the situation that you just described with this woman in Holland personally.
Oh.
I experienced postpartum depression that included hallucinations of my own dead body all over the house.
Oh, yeah.
And I was alone for 9 months with my baby while my husband was deployed, and I absolutely refused to see a psychologist because I did not want them to put me on any drugs. And I got better after about 18 months of alternative therapies.
Yes.
And it was very, very, very hard on my husband, who came home to a practically unrecognizable wife, but we made it. And I never harmed myself or my kids, but I definitely thought about it a lot. It's a big problem.
Yeah.
They estimate that 1 in 4 women experience postpartum depression, and very few people talk about it.
Yes. And it's totally wrong to give these women antidepressant drugs. It's totally wrong. Thank you for telling this. The amount of fraud in drug trials in psychiatry is gigantic. Deaths disappear, suicides disappear when the companies make trials. There is so much fraud here. This is one of the reasons that psychiatrists aren't aware how dangerous these drugs are. This is criminal on part of the drug industry. And it's so incredibly sad that you can even meet psychiatrists that believe that antidepressants protect children against suicide. So allow me to recommend to you one thing. I have a website that is called Deadly Medicines, in plural and in one word, .dk for Denmark. Deadly Medicines, you can easily find it. Just Google my name. We had a meeting last year in Denmark when my book came out, and I knew some women who had lost a husband or a son or a daughter to suicide caused by antidepressant drugs. And I informed these women about my meeting. Then they offered themselves to pay for themselves. They were not part of the program, but they would like to come and support me and tell their stories at the meeting. There were 5 women, 3 from America, 2 from Ireland. They got 12 minutes each, 1 hour. This was the highlight of the whole day. It is so moving to hear these women tell about how absurd it all is and how these suicides are disdainfully called anecdotes. These are just anecdotes. The randomized trials don't tell us that people die from suicide because of the drugs. And why don't they? Because the drug companies have been fraudulent. These are not anecdotes for those left behind.
Well, I'd like to just say from the start that I appreciate your concern about involuntary treatment and human dignity in making decisions. What I have is not so much a question as a personal statement. I have, and in giving this statement, I would like to say that I have both a strength and two weaknesses. The strength is that I'm a newcomer here to Arizona, to Alaska. I'm sorry, I came from Arizona. I've only been here in the state since January. And so in a sense, I bring a different vision from outside Alaska to the situation that you have here with involuntary treatment. The weakness that I have is that I'm both a psychiatrist and I work at Alaska Psychiatric Institute. And I think what I'd like to share is that I know most psychiatrists that I work with as deeply human, scientific, humanistic individuals who care very much about their patients and also about the science of their work. And most of them come to a different conclusion than you do, doctor. I would also like to say that working at Alaska Psychiatric Institute has been a great privilege, both in serving the clients that we serve and also in working with the treatment teams that we have at Alaska Psychiatric Institute. Again, the people that I work with are deeply humanistic people, all the way from the janitors, the aides, the housekeeping staff, the psychiatric nursing assistants who work on the front line with the clients, the nurses, the social workers. They care deeply about the patients that they're caring for. The psychiatrists, I would say, are in the same category. They're not different. They're not ignorant people. When we get to the issue of involuntary treatment, which is the minority of the work that we do, I think everybody feels a sense of conflict about that. And I would say personally that Alaska has a very robust system that asks the family members of involved individuals and other people who know and care about them in the community, as well as a court visitor who is supposed to be an unbiased individual, for advice to the judge who's making the decision. The patient has the opportunity to present his or her perspective. The psychiatrist has an opportunity to present a perspective. And I find the judge to be very considerate of the alternatives and looking at the issue, is there danger to self? Is there danger to others? Is there an inability to pursue one's own life goals? Over the wintertime, the judges ask, can this person survive if they're living on the streets, if they're living in the cold? Do they need to have some kind of shelter?
Can I respond to your question?
Well, of course you can respond. And I'd just like to finish my sentence because I'm almost done. But what I'm trying to say is that I don't think that it's the kind of description that you've given of heartless people that are interested only in pursuing power. In fact, I don't think it's that way at all.
Let me try to respond to what you said. I agree with you that many psychiatrists are like you have just described. I agree with that. But there are also other psychiatrists, and Louisa was exposed to some of these other psychiatrists. Otherwise, she wouldn't have been killed. The book I told you about. And power corrupts all people. It's not something with psychiatrists. Every one of us can become corrupted if we gain absolute power. There must always be some kind of power balance, not only in marriages, but in all human relationships. Otherwise, it goes wrong. It's not because of bad intentions, but it does go wrong. And when you tell me that you have a good system in Alaska, then I must disagree very much with you, because I have just seen what kind of system you have. I have seen petitions that were copy and paste. The same was written about all patients, no matter what their problem was. They were considered incompetent to give informed consent. And it was written about all of them that they had received these drugs before without side effects. It's virtually impossible to receive psychiatric drugs without side effects. And then it also said that without all these drugs, sometimes two antipsychotic drugs, which is bad medicine, plus an antiepileptic drug, plus lithium, plus a benzodiazepine, plus perhaps another benzodiazepine, then every time it was stated on that forum that without these drugs, the prognosis was poor, and with these drugs, the prognosis was good. This is definitely just not right. So I must disagree with you vehemently on this point, and I'm ready to stand up for it, but we won't arrive at any disagreement on this.
I think the general practitioners are the ones that are more responsible for over-prescribing psychiatric drugs than the psychiatrists are.
Yes.
And I agree with this man who's done a recent graduate of API. I'm quite proud of what I experienced in there, and I saw the same thing he did.
Yes, but as I said, I have already seen enough. What I witnessed yesterday in court was a sham process. It was not a fair process, not anywhere near being a fair process. And it's not good medicine to treat a psychiatric patient with many drugs at the same time. That's definitely bad medicine. Let me just add to your point that I am of the opinion that general practitioners should not be allowed to use psychiatric drugs at all, because these drugs are dangerous and they are a double-edged sword. And when people get side effects on one drug, it's usually interpreted as now you have a new disease, and then they get another drug, and a third drug, and a fourth drug, and then you don't know what you're doing. And not even the psychiatrists are good enough at this. And the general practitioners know less than the psychiatrists, so they shouldn't be allowed to use psychiatric drugs. Then we would have a more healthy population. And also, they use psychiatric drugs for virtually everything. If you are getting a divorce, if your husband drinks too much, or if you're being harassed at work, or if you have pain somewhere in the body, or almost whatever it is, the pill for everything. This is very bad. I agree with you completely.
All right. I kind of like to step virtually in the middle of this between two experts. And I don't doubt that there are very caring individuals at the Alaska Psychiatric Institute. At least I hope so. I don't think that needs to be emphasized. As a family member of a young son who traveled this journey, what I, as his very caring mother, was missing was information from the Alaska Psychiatric Institute. Obviously, there is a consumer movement out there that informs about the dangers of psychiatric drugs because they have traveled this journey. They are the expert, not the psychiatrist. And even as somebody who's working in the field, who's very informed, when this all happened, it hit me like a freight train. I believed the psychiatrist. Who else could I believe? Information was slow to come. Thank God my son, who is brilliant, very willful, and very annoying at times, insisted on not taking drugs. He took them for a while. He had the cold turkey that you talked about. We went through this. It was hell. But I was never informed by any community person from the Psychiatric Institute that sat me down and maybe said, well, you know, maybe you could, there's other information out there, maybe you want to inform yourself, so that I had an option. I was never given an educated option as a parent. And that, to this day, I am so angry about. I could have saved 2 years of my son's journey if we would have gone without meds, because he is clearly on his road of recovery without meds.
Let people go as long as they want, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we are talking meds, not caring people. We are talking a system that's wrong.
Well, let me respond to that. As I said, I'm sure that, like all other doctors, psychiatrists want to do a good job, but they, by and large, got the drugs wrong. And they have been fooled by a deeply criminal drug industry, and also by some of your own kind that are criminal and receive loads of dollars from the drug industry and perform substandard randomized trials that are biased, because then they will get more money even next time from the same company. So there is corruption among top psychiatrists in this country, and these are the psychiatrists that by far are those who participate in randomized trials. So we should have independent drug trials where no psychiatrists are allowed to participate if they have any financial relations to the drug industry, because you cannot be the advocate for your patients and for the drug industry at the same time and for your own income from the drug industry. It's not possible. So there are lots of things we could do. And one of the things we in particular could do is, I would so much want psychiatrists never to come up with a new diagnosis if they have a patient whose brain is already under chemical influence from another psychiatric drug. Now, if you get a patient from the street that has taken cocaine or LSD or marijuana and is deeply psychotic, you would not give that patient a diagnosis of schizophrenia. You would think, let's see if that person gets well in a couple of days and then he can or she can go home. But if you first treat a patient for one diagnosis, depression or ADHD, then some of the side effects and some of these things, these drug cures, actually are some of the same symptoms that define, for example, bipolar disorder. And then you cannot distinguish, is this only side effects or is it really bipolar disorder? You cannot find out unless you stop the first drug. I discussed this with a professor in Denmark, and I told him, the side effects of ADHD drugs, they are quite similar to those symptoms that define bipolar disorder. So how can you know whether it is a new disease or side effects? And he told me that I'm a psychiatrist, so I can distinguish between these two things. But I mean, it's more or less the same symptoms, so it's not possible. Then I gave up further discussion with that man. And particularly in your country, because of Biederman from Harvard, who has done a lot of these ADHD trials in children. Biederman comes up with the diagnosis bipolar in a surprisingly high number of children. Very few of these are genuinely bipolar. So I'm convinced that most psychiatrists want to do the right things, but you need to take up the fight against those of you who actually don't do what they should do.
Yeah, I have a question. Would anti-seizure drugs, as Dilantin and Depakote, mix with Haldol, Risperdal, and all the psychotropic drugs, does that play a part of any psychosis?
If it plays a part of psychosis?
Yes. When you mix those drugs?
Well, the problem of mixing several different types of drugs is that you can quickly end in a situation where you don't know what you're doing and you don't know what drug causes what.
Right.
Because many of these drugs can cause similar symptoms. So how will you find out which drug is the worst of them? So the prevailing polypharmacy in psychiatry, I believe, is very harmful. And as I said, psychiatric drugs should be used very, very little. I suggest in my new book, only 2% of current usage would make people live longer and be healthier, and to a greater degree come back to the work market, because at the same time as we use more and more psychiatric drugs, people on psychiatric disability pension just goes the same way. If these drugs have been so good, they should have gone the other way. So we're creating a lot of harm with psychiatric polypharmacy. There's absolutely no doubt about that.
I understand. Our son was, we have been here all of our life, and our son was medically kidnapped here in the state of Alaska and was taken over by the courts of the state of Alaska and was force drugged. He had received over 35 different psychotic medications, some that I do not know because there was a nurse practitioner that's a psychiatrist had actually petitioned the courts to take our son over, so they actually owned him. And the courts had, right here in the Alaska courts, had ordered him to go to John Hopkins medicine facilities clear on the east side coast from where you are to do a brain biopsy on him. Then they also court ordered him in the Washington courts to electrical shock him. But we have found one psychiatrist that was doing her job, and she's was wonderful, and that's Heidi Combs. She's the head psychiatrist at Harborview, and she actually saved my son's life and actually started withdrawing him off the drugs in a very immediate time.
Yes. Now, let me give you three examples that, despite the good intentions of psychiatrists, they are not doing the right things. And I will take my country. The National Board of Health recommends against using more than one antipsychotic at a time. Still, around half of the patients receive several antipsychotics at the same time. Some receive four or five. This is very bad medicine. We also recommend against combining an antipsychotic with a benzodiazepine because it seems to increase mortality by 50%. But then when you study what is going on, half of those in treatment with an antipsychotic drug also receives a benzodiazepine in my country. And then we have the dose problem. Despite clear evidence that you don't get bigger effect by increasing the dose of antidepressant drugs, that's very clear evidence, then this is what doctors do, that they try one dose, and if it's not too bad in terms of side effects, then after some weeks, they typically say, now we'll increase the dose. But you don't get more effect out of that, but you do get more harms. And it's the same with antipsychotics, that the higher dose and the longer you use it, the more harm you produce. And since treatments in psychiatry work so poorly, then out of desperation, psychiatrists, they try one drug after another and increase the dose and put other drugs on top of three or four that the patient is already receiving, and then everything just gets worse. So psychiatrists need to realize that those drugs they have are pretty poor drugs, and therefore they should invest in psychotherapy and use drugs very, very little.
Yeah, our son flew to New York and saw Peter Bergen, so I know what you're saying, but when you don't own yourself, when the state of Alaska takes you over, you don't own yourself, you don't have a choice. They force these drugs on by court order.
Now there is an interesting observation. How many people would take antipsychotics for years if they could decide themselves? These drugs, in my opinion, are so horrible that you need forced treatment to get anyone to take them. I know there are some patients now and then that say that these drugs help them, but by and large, they are bad drugs.
Well, he was drugged to be incompetent, and so they took him over that way. And
yes.
This is an epidemic. You know, there's a book that's put out, it's called medicalkidnap.com and also healthimpact.com, and they show all the states in America. You were speaking about America, but it happens all over the world. But if you can see by the states how many people are medically kidnapped. Arizona is probably one of the worst ones for, you know, kidnapping children. However, if you type in Alaska, you'll find, you know, our son's case as far as that goes. But like I said, our son had found a really good psychiatrist.
Yes.
And it was because of other legal issues that were going on and lies that were against us that she came into play. And and unfortunately, I mean, she was doing her job. She did, you know, she weaned him off the drugs, and he was fine. And he was you know, held for 8 months in a local hospital, and was forced drug, forced treatments, had a plasmathesis, strapped in a human vault and drugged, strapped by five security guards and against his will. And when he came about, they just drugged him more, and they just gave him drug more.
Yeah.
But when you don't own yourself, or you're the parents, your child is a ward of the state, you have no choice. And Alaska is extremely bad for that.
Let me say now, when I'm in America, that 2 years ago, I met with Peter Bregan, who invited me to lecture in Michigan at a course he had. And I have lectured with Peter Bregan a couple of times since then, also in Florida. I have read a number of his books and articles. That man doesn't use psychiatric drugs. He doesn't. And I know other psychiatrists that don't use psychiatric drugs because they have realized how dangerous and how ineffective they are. So there are people who do that. And Peter Bregan has had a difficult life, being ostracized by mainstream psychiatry. And I must say that this man is the best psychiatrist I have ever met.
Yeah, my son spent several hours with him, and days with him. And but I just want, you know, you were talking about basically the system, the evil system. You know, this has become an epidemic, and Alaska is right there. We like to think it's not. We like to think America is not, but it's worldwide. But here in America, it has increased. I don't know if you all know about the Justina Pelletier case that sort of kind of went on the same time as my son. But it does happen, and it's really sad. But there are good psychiatrists out there, and Peter Bregan and Heidi Combs is, you know, one of them. So,
they even tried to take his license from him, the American Psychiatric Association, a number of years ago when he sat at an Winfrey show, something about these drugs, that they weren't so good as people said. But of course, they didn't succeed to take his license from him. He's a very good psychiatrist. Now, there was another question there.
Basically, one thing you haven't mentioned is we have an insurance system here that is stacked against the patient. And I'm a social worker. And as the years have gone by, there's a specialty in short-term therapy. And it's because of the insurance companies. And if your insurance company will pay for any mental health in the first place, you only get it for maybe six sessions, maybe. So we have many psychiatrists connected with our mental health clinics that will see a patient maybe 15 minutes a month, and it's basically to get them their medications again. And so they're not even speaking with their patients. They're basically saying, here's your new meds. Here's the new prescription for your meds. And so a big driver in this country is the insurance companies. And they're the ones that will prescribe how long someone will see someone and prescribe what the treatment is going to be. And it's through the insurance companies.
Yes. There are always various systemic issues we need to work with. There will always be systemic issues that create the wrong incentives. So we need to change systems so that they create the right incentives. Doctors should be paid for curing patients and not for just renewing prescriptions and things like that, for example. And Yeah. I forgot what it was, I would tell you, but it was mainly about the incentives, I think, that were wrong. Yes, now I remember it, that there is a report from United Kingdom, but it builds on models, so you can always question the results, but an economic model that says that psychotherapy is actually cost effective. So the idea that we cannot afford psychotherapy, I believe, is a totally wrong one. What we cannot afford is this over-treatment and over-diagnosis of the population that turns so many acute problems into being something chronic, and then the patients don't come back to the work market. That is what we cannot afford.
Someone mentioned about alternatives in mental health, and I'm a physician, and I had a brother with a serious mental illness, and I called the police a number of times to take him to API. He was there about three times, and also in other state hospitals. He was also a medical student, but I saw many times psychiatrists would take him off of medications too rapidly. But when he was weaned off very slowly, then he was fine. And I saw one thing that helped on withdrawal from antipsychotics was to be on a lower protein plant-based diet, particularly extremely low protein at first. And I think that's one of the alternatives we could use much more in mental health. We use nutrition for heart disease and many other chronic illnesses. It's pretty widely known, but within mental health, we haven't used nutrition very much. But I'm pleased to hear that at API, they have labeled foods. I haven't been there myself recently, but I've heard they've labeled foods in the cafeteria as vegetarian or vegan. And I think that's one thing people might try. In Russia, they fasted over 10,000 patients with schizophrenia. With many illnesses.
Could I comment on that, please?
Allow me to comment on that. Evidence-based medicine is about using the best available treatments we have that have shown that they do more good than harm. So I always hear about nutrition when I lecture on psychiatry. But we need proof that nutrition works for psychiatric diseases, and I have not seen that proof, but let's not discuss that. I'm only saying I have not seen such proofs, and we need to show in randomized trials that things work before we go out and recommend them. The alternative to psychiatric drugs are, in my mind, not nutrition, because it hasn't a documented effect. It is no psychiatric drugs. That's a good alternative. And then we should focus on human behavior and empathy, psychotherapy. It works. But you need to document that something that has to do with nutrition works. So I don't have any more comment about that.
Hi, I've been taking anti-seizure drug from the time I was a little kid, and come to find out, I haven't had anti-seizure drug for 11 years, and no seizures because the anti-seizure drugs cause the seizures, Tegretol, Lamictal, and Dilantin. They all cause seizures, and they're all psychiatric drug too. I realize that we should do choice, but at what extent do we ban the drugs?
Oh, I'm on your side. I feel ADHD drugs should be taken off the market. They are harming our children and now also adults. And if you look at the trials, they are horribly low quality. We are looking at these trials in Copenhagen right now. They're absolutely horrible. And if you look at the long-term results, they don't look good. I also feel that that we don't need antidepressant drugs because I have come to the conclusion that they don't work either. And I'm not even sure we need antipsychotics because I think actually that we can use benzodiazepines instead. And epilepsy drugs I'm pretty skeptical about because these are pretty toxic drugs and they are called mood stabilizers, which I believe is audacious because how can you say that such a toxic drug stabilizes the mood? That's pretty far-fetched in my opinion. So we could ban a lot of these drugs, but that will never happen because it takes very little to get a drug approved. You just need two randomized trials that have shown some effect, no matter how small it is. And since these trials are not adequately blinded, you can show that virtually everything seems to work for virtually everything in psychiatry. But what you measure is mainly bias.
What figured out the problem was I was at the Swedish hospital in Washington State, and they wired me up and they took me off cold turkey. They were wanting to watch me have a seizure, and I was in the hospital for 2 weeks, and no seizure. I could finally think clearly after 15 years of taking the drug, and so they finally came to the conclusion that the drug was causing the seizures.
Caused the seizures, I see, yeah. Well, as I said earlier, psychiatric drugs are strange drugs because they can cause the diseases that they should actually work on. Antidepressant drugs can give you a new depression, particularly if you miss some doses and become abstinent, then you can become depressed. And that is not a true depression, because if you give yourself a full dose, you will usually be fine in a few hours' time. That's like if you give an alcoholic with abstinent symptoms a bottle of vodka, he will improve quite quickly. Whereas a genuine depression take some weeks before you recover from it. So a false depression, an abstinence depression that comes suddenly if you don't take your drug and get a cold turkey, you can diagnose it by giving yourself a full dose and then you will usually be fine again. So you're absolutely right. These drugs are very difficult drugs to handle. And the effects are often being misunderstood by the doctors, very often. I'm sorry, but that is the case.
My mother was recently involuntarily admitted against her will. The police department came to her house and pretty much rushed her out the door. She found herself locked up. Am I too quiet? My mother was locked up involuntarily, which was a really very, very, very frustrating thing for her. So much so, in fact, that I felt that she was probably more dangerous to herself being handcuffed and led into a police car and then taken to an involuntary facility than she would have been if she were just left alone. The physician who was brave enough to come in here and actually speak on the behalf of API, I honestly, if he were still here, I would thank him for that because I couldn't even imagine as a doctor working in one of those facilities, even bothering to come here to listen to this. Quite frankly, it's commendable that anybody would even try to stand up in the face of what is overwhelming evidence. Psychiatry is clearly guilty of hubris. If anybody doesn't know what hubris means, it means pride and arrogance. They clearly believe themselves capable of accomplishing something which they have never been able to prove they can actually accomplish. I do have a question. Is death a bad thing, doctor? Is death a bad thing? As a doctor, is it your job to prevent death?
It's very hollow when you talk in the microphone. Are you asking if death is
a... I am asking if death is a bad thing. As you, as a doctor, do you believe that death is a bad thing?
That's a question that can't be answered. I mean, that's a question like, have you stopped beating your wife? If you ask yes, and if you ask no, both things are wrong. So I can't reply to a question like that.
So it's an unfair question.
Death is sometimes a welcome outcome in a desperate situation, but usually it's not.
It is a welcome outcome under certain circumstances.
In some circumstances, it's a welcome outcome. You know that.
Is it a welcome outcome when you're in the care of a psychiatrist?
Well, you're being a little teasing now.
Well, if I could say something, you know, people in the public mental health system are dying 25 years earlier. On average in the general population, and that didn't used to be true, and that there's no outcry over that suggests to me that that's an acceptable outcome by society.
Isn't one of the reasons that things like nutrition are not well understood because the drug companies have basically taken over most research, even at the university level, where there at least was independent study, so that there's really no incentive to do those sorts of studies because the money can't be made.
Yes, that's true. You cannot patent an apple. So there's no money in studies like that. But then they need to get financed by public funding, and we have such fundings, and loads of nutrition studies have been made in all sorts of diseases, rheumatoid arthritis and all sorts of diseases. So these studies, they do exist, but very little have come out of them. Many people believe that nutrition is very important, but when you study nutrition in randomized trials, I must say that the results have been pretty disappointing in general. So that's why I just have a natural skepticism that is empirically founded.
And you feel that the studies were well designed and properly conducted?
Well, there are so many nutrition studies, so some of them were well designed, and some of them have been very interesting, like the Mediterranean diet with olive oil and that sort of thing. You have heard about that for heart disease but you know, if you're looking at cost advice, is that what you call it? Cost? No, that's the money. What you eat, nutritional advice. I mean, it varies over the years. One year, this type of nutrition is healthy, and the next year, it's the opposite. And now you need to eat little fat or much fat and look at the Eskimos in Greenland and, oh, you can get almost what you want in terms of results and recommendations. So I hope we'll find out something someday that can be helpful.
I wonder with research for nutritional regimens, if it isn't the same attempt as one fix all as the medication attempts. We want one thing to fix all the things. Yeah. And as far as nutrition goes, my belief is some things help some people some of the time. We are all individuals, we have individual metabolism, some diets help some people, not others. But nutrition, wonderful, natural as it sounds, we need to shy away from this helps everybody.
Yeah, I have a little recommendation, actually. I have a little recommendation about nutrition and life in general. Don't worry, be happy. We shall all die.
If there are no other questions, there is some food out there, and we'll have it. Dr. Gøtzsche and Peter will be available. Let's give them a round of applause. I think